A very good morning once again. Thank you for joining us here on Urban TV. This is The Big Issue. My name is Lynn Komjisha in the rush hour. It's a cold, chilly Friday morning, but I hope it is promising us a good weekend. So do join our conversations on social media at Urban TV Uganda on Twitter, Urban Television on Facebook, and be part of these conversations that we are having. And to tell you the truth, today's big issue is of national importance. Yes, yes, I just wanted to say that. But thank you for joining us. Today is also International Anti-Corruption Day, and the global theme is that uniting the world against corruption. And if you remember very recently, the statement from the Ethics and Integrity Minister, Rose Lily Akello, highlighted the plight of anti-graft agencies which are struggling to force corrupt officials to drop their loot. In Uganda, we are celebrating this day in Ibanda District under the theme, Citizens Must Own the War to Eliminate Corruption, and they're saying it is their war. Some very interesting statistics or reports from the Inspectorate of Government office, and they're saying that whereas 18.2 billion shillings was identified as proceeds of crime to be returned to public coffers, the minister said that only 7 billion has been recovered. The Auditor General is no different. So those are some of the issues surrounding our, you know, anti-graft or anti-corruption campaigns around the country. But relatedly, we also know that there's corruption in every corner of this society, and we also have been seeing that one of the ministers of Uganda has been in the spotlight over a few issues, especially in regards to land land matters, but land in Nakawa particularly. And the minister is Persis Namaganza, state minister for lands, for urban development, Persis Namaganza. She's on the spotlight for a lot of things, but joining me to discuss that and so much more is a very senior journalist here at Vision Group. They're multimedia journalists and they cover parliament. They have been in politics, they have seen all these things. We're going to have that conversation. Understand what is the fight against corruption, and also what is happening with Persis Namaganza. I welcome Moses Mulondo and John Odek. A very good morning, gentlemen.
Good morning. Thank you very much.
Fantastic. I want us to quickly dive into it. I want to start with you, Moses. What is all this happening around Persis Namaganza, and how is it related to our fight against corruption?
Of course, it culminated from an ad hoc committee that was constituted to investigate the manner in which land at Nagulu Nakawa was passed out to different individuals. But after the committee that was headed by Dan Kimosho had completed investigations, of course, I remember one of their recommendations was that the minister, Persis Namaganza, did a lot of influence peddling in determining who gets what, and in many instances she was fronting the name of the president, and the president has directed give so and so land, the president has directed give this company land. So, and because of that, you know, that land, by the way, is very prime land, which is at the center of the city.
That's true.
Many people, in fact, believe that land shouldn't have been given to individuals, private individuals, because we have so many public entities, government entities that are renting, that are in rented premises, and we spend close to 200 billion every year paying rent for those entities. Government should have used that land to construct offices for those entities. So when the committee completed its investigations, the minister made attempts, actually, even she went to court and lost a case, and she attacked the leadership of parliament. In her thinking, I think she thought the leadership of parliament was witch hunting her, and she was even questioning why the leadership of parliament was constituting ad hoc committees when there are sectoral committees that should be handling such matters. So when she attacked the leadership of parliament and And even said she cannot be censured. Later, around July, one of the MPs, Solomon Siriwan from Busoga, from Bukoli Central, rose on the floor of Parliament and raised those issues she had echoed on some television and on social media platforms. And that is when the Speaker of Parliament directed that she's sent to the Rules and Privileges Committee to be investigated for disciplinary action. And that committee is headed by Abdu Katuntu. So the committee, in the course of investigating, they summoned her several times and she was not turning up. And when she turned up, she was telling them they cannot continue with the process because she had already gone to the court. At some point, she even stormed out of the meeting in protest and said she did not agree with the process. The committee got perplexed, and at some point, they had to consult the speaker, Anita Among, on what to do. And the speaker guided them that from what she had gathered, the process was not in contempt of the court, as she was arguing, because they were specifically investigating her conduct of attacking the institution of Parliament, and not on the outcome of the Naguru Nakawa probe. So the committee continued and completed the process and made the report. And in their report, they recommended that the minister should be censured, should be relieved of her duties. In their judgment, she's not fit to be a minister. So in the course of debating that report, of course, again, Persis Namuganza put up a fight and was trying again to block the process of debating the report, saying she had already gone to court.
Mm-hmm.
And in the course of that, she even again attacked the speaker. And that's where we are. But of course, it culminated from the Naguru Nakawa probe.
Yes,
and
yes.
Of course, it is linked to corruption because... It was on the basis of that the committee had recommended that she is relieved of her, duties by the chief executive, which the chief executive did not do. And I think that is why the MPs chose to take another option of pushing for her censure, which the process has not yet started, censuring her.
Yeah.
But certainly the committee already adopted, Parliament as
already
a whole
adopted
the committee report.
Mm-hmm.
Including that proposal of embarking on a process of censuring her.
We will get to the process of censuring her. But now, John, from all that we have heard about Persis Namuganza and how we have arrived at this, what do you think is wrong? Is it because she did not pay attention to the rules of procedure of Parliament? Is it because she may be unaware, or... is she actually right that maybe Parliament was overstepping its position?
As you have said, the rules of procedure
are there, but I think many MPs don't take time to read them. But even without the rules of procedure, most of these things have to do with common sense. So, for example, if you are working in an institution, how do you conduct yourself in that institution? So in this case, where she's caught offside is when you go outside Parliament and you start criticizing it on social media. I think it doesn't go well. Even, for example, if you're in a family and you go to criticize your family members outside the home, instead of resolving some of these things inside. So it will require that those differences, you try as much as possible to resolve it within the family or within the institution. But also, more to that is the issue of lack of experience, lack of advisors.
This is her second term.
Well, it's not so much the years. Probably you are there, but you're not learning anything.
Mm-hmm.
You know, experience, if you don't learn from your experience, you don't, even if you take 40 years, you don't learn anything. There are people who make the same mistake. Also, part of the issues have to do with her character, personal character. I think, you know, when you're in that kind of leadership position, you need to nurture mold yourself differently, develop character. I also think that this issue is going to become a kind of a fight against a woman. Like, I sympathize with her because she's like one man against so many men. I think that we are going to look at that issue on a gender perspective again. So probably she got emotional at times. She gets emotional. You remember the time she was crying on UBC TV that people wanted to kill her?
Mm-hmm.
So those are some of the weaknesses. But I think that she needs some advisors. She needs to
listen. But she needs to. They were actually begging her. That's what they said. They were begging her to apologize. You know, when you say emotional, and then we play the gender card, are we not trying to exonerate her of the crime that she's, or the, okay.
All those are the broader issues. The broader issues to look at. You know, she has been, could I use the word, hiding under the pretext of the presidential letters. But again, she cannot get away with that because from previous people who defended themselves that the president gave them similar letters, Parliament has put a high bar for them to say, well, you are the one in charge. You should make a scrutiny and advise the president. So if the president advises you to give land to quack investors, you have to do the necessary due diligence before you give the land to quack investors. Therefore, that's why it would appear that probably she is corrupt or in bed with the corrupt people. That's why she was giving land and now hiding under the presidential directive.
Mm-hmm.
But one of our concerns was actually that the special ad hoc committee that investigated Naguru Nakawa, she said the committee came up with a conclusion without having met the president who was part of the investigation, because her claim is that she got instructions from the president to allocate land to some individuals. And the committee was here indicting her that she was making fake claims, but they did not have an interface with the president to ascertain whether her claims were true or not. Because we've seen so many other incidents in the past where the president has directed ministers and different individuals responsible to allocate land to different individuals. I remember there was a letter I saw when Daud Migeleko was still minister for lands. The president sent him a letter to allocate land to Sudil, the Namulonge land. I think eventually Sudil was given part of that Namulonge land. Mm-hmm. So we have seen so many similar incidents in the past where the president gives directives to ministers to make certain decisions. I remember I come from where we had our MP, Katkamsa, former MP, Kidu Makuya, when he was the Attorney General, and at that time, again, the president directed him to give money to Basajja Balaba. You remember that scandal, Basajja Balaba? 165 billions, and he expedited the process, and Basajja Balaba was given money, but when the matter came up in Parliament, it was discovered that the figure had even been inflated, and so much pressure was put on Chidu Makuya and the then Minister for Finance, Saida Bumba, to resign. And eventually, by the way, they resigned. But when they attempted to take Chidu Makuya to the anti-corruption court over that matter, he actually threatened and said, I'm going to spill beans. I'm going to spill, to reveal secrets if I am taken there. Up to now, they have never taken him there.
So with all this, it seems there's a misinterpretation of the presidential directives. And also a misinterpretation of the rules of procedure, because Namaganza is saying the ad hoc committees, we have substantive committees of parliament, they should be the ones to handle matters that fall under their responsibilities. Why ad hoc? As if they are hired by the speaker to embarrass. That is what she said. Now, those are two things. Are they misinterpreting the presidential directives? And is Namaganza really right to say that ad hoc committees are really set to attack them? What do you think?
I think what is happening now, we need to examine all these statements. For example, the question of the presidential directive. We examine it on its own. If there's a presidential directive, does it
how
mean,
should it be handled?
How should it be handled? Does it mean you should do the wrong things? For example, I've just been speaking to the camera person here that if you get a letter from your boss that put the camera on the right side when you know that it should be on the left side, would you say my boss said I put it on the right side?
Yes.
Okay, yes, you could argue like that. Now, when you are caught, if the images are wrong, who is to blame? You'd say, yes, my boss told me to put it on the right side, but you knew that's supposed to be on the left side. Mm-hmm. So that's the kind of argument now we get involved, and that's what Namuganza is getting. But again, we're questioning, first of all, we don't see the letters. If there was a letter, yes, it would be okay, let's see it. But even if there was no letter, now we are assuming there was a letter.
Maybe it was a telephone call.
Oh, it's a telephone call. Okay, we are examining that. You claim there was a letter, a telephone call. Now, has the land been given to the right people? Has the investor done what he agreed that they should do? Mm. Maybe you go and check on the investors. They are not even there. They are a shell, you know, they are quacks. Then if you investigate further, you find that there are other interested individuals surrounding you, the person who's giving the land, you know them. So that raises the question. Now, the other issue is about what kind of committee is probing you. I think the issue is not so much trying to attack the credibility of the whatever committee is set. The thing is that, have they done their work in a fair manner? Were they fair? Did they give the chance to be heard? Like in this case, Namuganza would appear before the committee and walk away. She would come with a lawyer, and even before the committee has ended,
she has walked
out and said, you have no power.
But she kept saying that she's not being heard. Moses, I think you've heard that.
I think at the end of the day,
not given her
when she realized that
she said parliament acted like a mob
against
her. Well, in the final plenary, it appeared like a mob, but the long procedure hearings where she didn't appear, or if she appeared, she would walk out.
Should have defended herself then.
Yeah, should have defended herself. So, well, when you're in the plenary, like Semuju said, it is time for decision making. It's no longer a hearing.
Mm.
So it's like there's a principle of law that once the hearings have been made, the judges have to make a decision. And in this case, the plenary turned out to be the judges for this case. So whatever comes out is based on. They cannot start another hearing in the plenary, otherwise it will take on forever and there are other business.
There are other important matters. Yes, Moses, yes. I want us to look at the issue. This parliament seems to be missing out on a lot of, maybe they have not read their rules of procedure. We have several cases of people going to the disciplinary committee. Is it that members of parliament do not know these rules of procedure, or is it character versus positions?
Of course, it's a combination of many factors.
Mm.
I can give you like the example of Zake,
yes,
the Mitiana MP, municipality MP. It is not that he didn't know the rules, but as a member of the National Unity Platform, he was very aggrieved that their members are being abducted. By that time, Chagulani's bodyguard, Jamshid Kavuma, had been abducted by security officers. And for so many days, they didn't know his whereabouts.
Mm-hmm.
And so many other NUP members were being abducted. Thousands are still in jail. So it was deliberate. He even said it somewhere that he intended to behave in such a way so that he could actually send a message to the nation that something has to be done to stop these abductions and to have the political prisoners are set free.
But
and I can tell you, by the way, he was praised on different social media platforms, and many people were saying this is the only opposition MP that we have.
I totally agree with whatever plans he had. Okay, to make a statement. But is that right for him to do in parliament?
Actually, if I may come in there quickly and say, you know, he's behaving like these other North Africans when they play football. So one of the ambassadors here told me that there's a word called a drama queen. So this Zake is trying to become like a drama queen. I don't know, maybe a drama king.
I think there's
a way we can present things. You see, I would like someone actually to quote me on this statement where sometimes MPs say that Parliament is not a national theater.
Exactly, it's not.
So now, when I go to the national theater, they say that a national theater is not a parliament. So you see that we should not. The national theater is a very important institution, and what they do there is not a joking issue. So the
parliament
should also not turn into a drama kind of scenario.
Mm-hmm.
So you see, in the past, there's one MP called Ekanya who tried to strangle himself with a tie that because they are not given their district, they were not given a district. So he wanted to strangle himself with a tie. But all I'm trying to say is that, unfortunately, for this kind of meetings, there's a way you're supposed to present your arguments in a sober manner. Recently, we had a fight in the parliament, Senegal, where a gentleman came and punched a lady and she collapsed. So if we start throwing chairs at each other because you have to make a point, I don't know whether it will really
help. The other day there was a scuffle and somebody collapsed. If you remember, during the East African Legislative Assembly elections, there was a lot of things.
Yes. Why I disagree with him?
Yes.
Even in Europe, by the way, people even flex muscles in Parliament to make a point.
Mm-hmm.
But even in the Bible, the most peaceful man, Jesus, when he entered the temple which had been turned into a market, he had to turn tables upside down and had to beat people to make a point. So when you look at the political environment in which we are operating, in fact, the leader of opposition, Mathias Mpuuga, is under so much pressure.
That's
and
true.
Is being accused of being too diplomatic, and yet the political environment is abnormal. He's trying, these are being accused of trying to be normal in an abnormal situation.
Mm-hmm.
And that is why Zakeo was greatly praised. So, the political environment in which we are operating sometimes requires radicalism.
Mm-hmm.
And Zake did actually is the least of the radicalism, because I imagine there will come a situation where people will have to flex muscles, someone will have to step on the table of the speaker to make a point.
But you see.
And as I conclude.
Yeah.
The highest form of radicalism in politics is actually picking up arms, like what President Yoweri Museveni did and went to Luwelo. And
but you don't do it within the confines of parliament. You don't do it in the confines of parliament.
Yeah. I'm saying there are different forms of political radicalism, and that is one of them.
But what I want to ask Moses is that, are you saying that because you're a carpenter, every time you have to use a hammer, even there's a mosquito?
Of course, not
hammer.
Always. Of course,
or
not
because
always.
Jesus
but
beat
once
people,
in a while.
Because Jesus beat it's people in the temple.
I want us to come back to mm-hmm. Parliament for one reason. Parliament is an institution, independent institution, and it has its rules, it has its procedures, it has ways of operation in Parliament. Now, when we have members of Parliament breaching these rules and going astray.
Even before you go so far, I think the Deputy Speaker at that time was taking a caution.
Mm.
Because when you start allowing drama to start,
mm-hmm.
the whole house can descend in chaos.
Absolutely.
And even to make matters worse, Zake has been asked to appear before the Rules Committee and he has refused. Now, such conduct.
Now, this is where we are. Mm-hmm. We have now a minister censured.
Mm-hmm.
Actually, he has refused. He has been invited before and he appeared before the committee. I don't think he can refuse.
This
he will eventually appear and give
even
reasons why he behaved.
Remember previously when he boxed in Nawangwe,
mm-hmm.
where did that case end?
It was.
He was claiming
when
there
he
was no. Yeah, it was the first day.
When Nawangwe. He only verbally.
It was an altercation.
Yeah.
But do you know where the case ended?
When
because they're asking for the camera footage for the. For the scaffold.
But
so that's what I'm saying. All it has to do with conduct. Even when they requested him to appear, he was using legal technicalities. Where's the footage? Where's the evidence? You know, all these things. Even here, they have actually asked him. I've seen the committee sitting several times waiting for him. He hasn't. Actually,
but by the way, some people think, and I think I tend to agree with them,
mm-hmm.
that given the gravity of the matter that Zake was raising, of abductions of Ugandans, it was not even necessary for the Deputy Speaker to have referred him to the Rules Committee for Disciplinary Action. that the speaker should have actually used that occasion to also speak out against these incidents of abducting Ugandans.
But now that you're thousands of them he would have set a precedent of allowing chaos in the parliament.
I think Moses
and becoming
Moses
behavior.
This is not something
point.
That happens every day.
Moses
it's
has
it is not that every
he has
week.
Made a good point, but the conclusions are wrong. You see, it is true that the case of the two MPs arrested is a very serious issue.
Mm-hmm.
But the question is, should we handle it by creating drama in parliament? And I think parliament has made its case so many times, not only parliament, even the Uganda Human Rights Commission has raised this issue.
Mm-hmm.
There have been so many people who have raised this thing on the order, on the floor of parliament in a calm manner.
Mm-hmm.
You see, so I think this militant approach, well, it works in some cases, but the problem is that if we use a militant approach to politics, remember the other time when opposition tried that, then they had to bring in other military fellows to calm down the situation.
Mm, yeah.
Now imagine Zake could start the drama and he ends up breaking a microphone. Then they invite the sergeant at arms to bring in security operatives.
And it will become a normal.
Yes.
It will become everyday business. Moses, because you've been in parliament a lot, let us look at these recommendations given in the report against Namuganza. They're saying, there are two of them that caught my attention. Uphold the duty to maintain and strengthen the public's trust and confidence in the integrity of parliament at all times, and desist from behavior that denigrates the integrity and reputation of parliament. Two, parliament should orient members on the rules of procedure with special emphasis on the code of conduct for members of parliament and mechanisms available in the rules of resolving personal grievances. In these issues, we have seen Namuganza she not only has personal issues against some members of parliament and the institution itself, but also has her own, you know, problems that where she has gone wrong. What does parliament, what was she supposed to have done in the first place? She was sent to the rules of procedure and discipline committee, and there she failed. She went to court. Was she right in the first place to go to court, take parliament to court?
Of course, in her own judgment, she was right because she was fighting her battle. But talking about the image of parliament, there are things which taint the image of parliament, because just someone being emotional and they speak their mind about how parliament is doing work is the least of the things that can affect the image of parliament. But you see, in the public domain, the image of our parliament actually is not good.
Very bad.
First of all, when you look at the way they keep increasing their emoluments, when you look at the way different incidents of MPs being bribed to support certain causes, so there are many actions that have greatly tainted the image of that parliament. And if they are really serious about redeeming the image of that parliament, they have to look into those things. I can give you an example. When parliament was processing the Computer Misuse Amendment Bill, as a president of Uganda Parliamentary Press Association, I am one of the stakeholders that appeared before the ICT committee, headed by Mr. Magogo Moses. But I can tell you, I followed the proceedings of that committee. And this was even said by this gentleman, the chairperson of the Uganda Media Council, because he also appeared with the ICT ministry. All the stakeholders that appeared before the committee rejected the bill. All the stakeholders.
Mm-hmm.
And I am one of them. But when the committee finally came up with the report, the final report, the report was completely detached from the views of the stakeholders that appeared before the committee. And eventually parliament passed a bill which was not popular in the public domain. So it is such actions really that greatly undermine and damage the image of the institution of parliament. Even when they were, let me leave that one out. But I can tell you there are so many.
But Moses,
there are so many scenarios and actions that are done by the MPs, by the committees of parliament, by the leadership of parliament, which damage the image of the institution of parliament. And for me, that is where we need to focus. By the way, as we continue debating, because I know we have 1 hour here, I thought we needed to allocate more time to debating generally the issue of corruption. Of course, it is linked to what happened in that ad hoc committee and the recommendations that were. But as we continue discussing, mm-hmm. I would wish that we focus more on how, as a country, we can fight corruption. Because, by the way, according to Transparency International, Uganda is one of the countries that have not made significant progress in fighting corruption in the last 10 years. I have statistics I will be giving them.
You will share all that later, yes. But I want us to first address the issue of Namugaza. It's the one on the table. Yeah, John, you had something to say.
So I wanted to say that, Moses, you need to qualify your statement about the computer misuse law. It's not that all stakeholders rejected it. There's quite a number of
you
people.
Tell me one who supported there's quite it. Even quite the ICT ministry rejected it. No, Uganda Law Society rejected it. All media associations rejected it.
I wanted to qualify. You know, we may not like the bill as individuals, but there are quite a number of people who are happy with it. And then we need to look at things in perspective. We can't say everyone.
No, you tell me one stakeholder who appeared before.
Quite a number
who supported
of people.
It. Just mention one. I have told you even the
but
line
you
ministry.
You can't say that the bill is passed before the House without support.
You tell me one.
We can.
Well, how did it go through without support like support. Here?
Well, of course, there are some individual leaders, especially political leaders, who were pushing for that bill, who even sponsored it. And I don't want to go into the details of.
But we can go into that.
Many members of the public
will get to that. John,
but what I wanted to mention is that, again, we should not, when we talk about some of these challenges between institutions and individuals. Well, there's a song which says that individuals come and go, you know. The institution will remain. There are individual mistakes by Namuganza. Like, look at the previous parliaments. People like Rebecca Kadaga, they have done great. They have come and gone. So, but the institution stays. It is the individuals who are supposed to make the institution stand. But if you look at the laws which set out parliament, it is clear what the role of parliament is. But if individuals make mistakes, we cannot say, it is the institution making the mistake. Mm. And then also, I also sympathize with the Namuganza. You know, many people are trying to be like angels. We all make mistakes. I think she could be making a political mistake now. Like, everybody needs a second chance. So whatever comes out, I think we just need to give her a chance. We are not angels.
Is it not too late for her?
Whatever is going to happen, you know.
It's not yet late because
there's a debate.
The censoring process has not
started. In the history of democracy and all, you remember in France, people used to execute others in the name of liberty. Mm-hmm. So they executed so many people because they thought they are trying to bring democracy and leadership. And some of these actions were wrong. Later, people realized, no, we were just acting emotionally. Probably, whatever will happen, she's not going to be the first or the last to make these mistakes. And also, I think the rules of procedure are there. Many people don't read it, but it's all about common sense. There's really nothing in the rules of procedure that is out of the way, like something about code of conduct. How it talks about dress code. I think people don't even bother to read it. Like yesterday, they almost ejected an MP for not wearing a tie. So would you say you have not read the rules of procedure? Some people don't even if you don't read those rules, you just see your colleagues putting on a tie, you ask, why is everyone wearing a tie? If you don't want to read, you put on the tie. For example, would a lady come in a mini dress in parliament when you see everyone in a suit? You definitely can't. It's just common sense. I'm in parliament. I should not come in a short
but
dress.
You shouldn't, you know, muzzle my my freedom. While I'm doing
that's
whatever.
Now a lady's issue.
No, not really. Now, Moses, I still don't understand when we want our members of parliament to be as free as they can and, you know, do whatever they want on the floor of parliament. Are we saying that we are now accepting unbecoming behavior? on the floor of parliament, then what happens next?
Actually,
me and many others believe that we have not yet even seen enough.
The
you
worst.
See, when you look at the political environment that is
but
in our country,
mm-hmm. What's
you,
wrong
you have
with it?
Two MPs, they were arrested more than 1 year ago.
Agreed.
On what many people think they are trumped up charges that they were behind the Bijambia in Masaka. And up to now, they are still in jail. They have not yet been released. You have thousands of young people who were arrested. You remember during and after the riots that happened in November 2020, thousands of them, by the way, even police has appeared before committees
thousands,
of parliament, and they have given figures. They are in thousands. And a big number of them have never been even produced before courts of law.
Mm-hmm.
But from the time the 2021 elections ended, the arrests have continued. You've been hearing about drones. They continue to abduct Ugandans.
Mm-hmm.
So that kind of political environment, and that is why some people have now resorted to even collecting guns. You've been seeing individuals who are yet to be known. Police says they are rebels. They are attacking police posts in different, even military facilities. They have killed soldiers and taken guns. And the reports are these people are planning to start a rebel movement to overthrow this government. So the political environment in our country, given the political environment in our country, we've not yet seen enough of that kind of radicalism. I think at some point we shall see some MPs jumping and trying to strangle some ministers who are responsible for certain actions, or stepping on the table of the speaker, or even going for the speaker. So many people think I have seen debates on this issue on different platforms, on the social media platforms, and people were saying we've not yet seen enough, given the political environment that is prevailing in our country. Mm-hmm. So
we should prepare and accept the unbecoming behavior of especially members of parliament.
I already told you these things happen all over the world.
They
even
do.
In the most civilized countries,
it's the frequency
in their parliaments, we see MPs boxing each other.
It's the
when they are
emotional
and discussing a very pertinent national issue.
Mm-hmm.
So I even gave you the example of Jesus when he entered the temple.
Moses, no.
Sometimes radicalism.
See, radicalism is necessary sometimes.
To make a
but
point.
You should do it within the confines of the institution.
Lynn, my fear is that Moses is making it as if every day we go to parliament,
yeah.
People are boxing each other.
That's not what I said.
Or breaking the microphone. Or everyone is.
But once in a while,
or Jesus.
It is necessary for someone to make a point.
But Jesus did that thing only once, and I think he even regretted it.
That's
like
why I'm saying once in a while.
Like the president
he didn't regret.
That,
Jesus
did. Jesus
okay,
did not
let's
even,
listen to each other.
Jesus did not even compensate people for breaking the tables. So, but that approach of military, radical militarism, is a very dangerous kind of approach because the state has the access to the means of what? Oppression or suppression. If you use a militant approach, the state will be scared and come up with the maximum force. So one case of Zakhe coming, and on a daily basis, By the way, and what is interesting is not even, I wish even women were doing this. What's interesting is the men doing it. If 10 women were behaving like Zakhe, we could say yes. It seems there's a trend coming up where all our issues have to be resolved by
radical
measure. When the speaker says sit down, you continue talking, you know, or you throw down the microphone.
And I find that really very unbecoming of members of parliament.
Mm-hmm.
Surely, if
that's
if,
a very
if,
small matter, you people just refusing to sit down.
No. But
just refusing to sit that for you to make your point.
What precedent are you setting? What example are you setting when we have matters of national importance to discuss,
and it's just
to debate,
it's
and
just
and
like
look at the intention, the motive. He is trying to communicate a message about a situation that is abnormal. And that is how actually we came to debate it everywhere because of what had happened. Before that, we had not had a serious debate as a country on the issue of abductions. In fact, the speaker was even compelled to convene meetings between the prime minister, some ministers, and the leadership of opposition. And I'm told on Tuesday, Yeah. They will be making a formal communication mm-hmm. from the discussions they have been having.
Mm-hmm.
So it all culminated from that incident. I think Zakeh has scored because we had not seen that kind of action before whatever he did.
Mm-hmm.
Yes. So
we should allow our ministers, our members of parliament, to demean and have no respect
but
for
I think Linde the
it's
thing,
not about demeaning
a few
the young you, man Zakeh just wanted to make
there's
a point.
A few things He's that we
young
need
man
to
and
ignite
a point. You can still make
on
a point
the abductions that are happening in the country
without being an orderly.
I think what we need to look at is that Zakeh's approach is unique. I'm not saying he's wrong. As I said, that he has got a history. For example, remember the other time when unfortunately he was boxed by Katumba Wamala during the was it age limit issue?
The issue of Katumba Wamala.
He was punched over there and Katumba went and apologized in hospital. Well, I don't know how strong the punch was, but remember he ended up in hospital.
I don't remember that
incident. And the other incident was when Nawange appeared before the committee. You remember the issue when Nawange was sacking the university staff? And Zakeh used that similar approach to create a scaffold scene in the committee. And Nawange actually appealed to parliament and he complained that he was harassed by Zakeh specifically. There was a hearing, but as I said, it failed because they asked for the footage of the scaffold. I think they said there was a scaffold inside the parliament and on the corridors, but it is alleged that the footage disappeared, and that's how the case also disappeared. Now, recently, Zakeh has used the same approach to come and create drama on the floor of parliament. I'm not saying it's right or wrong, but there's a fundamental,
why
a very important...
It's drama, is it not?
A drama,
It's not drama as such.
It's what? It's a form of expression.
Of course. And
but it's a drama.
Zakeh is just using his mouth, by the way, to do activism and speak out against the excesses of government. But some other people, like President Yoweri Museveni, went to the extreme and picked arms and started killing people, and they overthrew a government and entered the government.
It's a whole other story. Totally
I come
different.
From Luwelo. The area was not left the same. We lost over 500 Ugandans in that war.
But Lynn, there's something before we lose point. You see, the issue is that there's a way an MP is required to behave.
Yes. It's what I kept asking Moses, and he kept running away from.
So the question was, are we free to do what we want? Not exactly. The way an MP conducts himself is defined by the oath he took to become a member of parliament. I think they take two oaths. Secondly, there's a constitution which defines the role of an MP, what the MP does, and when he sits in the parliament, what's the role of parliament.
The presentation is one of them, and he was representing his
now,
members who have been...
Now, the other thing...
Let John finish.
So the other thing is that then when there are the rules of procedure which guide your behavior, whether you're in session in the parliament, whether in the committee, whether you're outside the parliament, inside, there are all those rules which govern the way an MP conducts himself. Even more to that, I always use the point about someone always told me that use common sense. If you are not sure of anything, just use common sense.
It's not common to everybody.
Okay. What I'm saying is, like, for example, if you go somewhere and people are taking off shoes,
you should also take
you
them.
Look.
What if they are...
No, I'm saying if you are not sure. If there is no rule which says take off the shoes, but you see everyone has taken off shoes, then you use common sense and say...
And you...
Probably... Okay, you could
might
also
lose
judge
your feet.
And say don't take off. So all those are decisions which... the outcome of your decision will be judged, how you made the judgment.
Okay.
I can see we have only 9 minutes left.
We have a few minutes. And I want us
to seriously talk about corruption.
Yes, I want you to... There are two things I want you to talk about. One, the current situation, parliament situation, the rules of procedure aside, is all this a form of corruption, first of all? Aren't our parliamentarians denying us our opportunity to give us the services that we expect them to work on? to legislate.
To the contrary, actually, some people think that Parliament is finally waking up.
Is it?
To bite and fight corruption. Because one of the accusations against Namuganza was that she was involved in influence peddling in giving out to land in Nagurunakawa, and some people think maybe she was bribed by some of the beneficiaries.
Mm-hmm.
But talking about corruption as a country, we still have a long way to go, because according to Transparency International Corruption Index report, the latest one, we are in position 144. The previous year we were in position 142, and the year before that, 3 years ago, we were in position 137. So we have been declining. So what actually that means?
So why are you saying that Parliament is doing something?
What that actually means? This is just a recent. Of course, I said some people think Parliament is finally starting to bite. It actually means that corruption is on the rise in Uganda. In that report, by the way, no single African country is among the 40 least corrupt countries in the world. But Rwanda and Mauritius and Botswana, at least Rwanda is in position 52. Botswana is in position 55 and Mauritius 49. So the three least corrupt countries on the African continent, our neighbor Rwanda is one of them.
But how are we going to fight corruption when we have people wasting our time in Parliament being radical and throwing stones and chairs at each other? How are we going to fight corruption?
But those people you are talking about, the Zakes, are not actually the ones to play the leading role in fighting corruption. The leading role in eliminating corruption is supposed to be played by the top leaders in this country who are occupying the top positions. And these are the leaders who have not done enough. Because according to that report of Transparency International, Uganda is one of the countries that have not registered significant progress in fighting corruption in the last 10 years. So it is incumbent upon our leaders, because we see the president appointing ministers, some of them, when you look at their history, they were involved in corruption, but he appoints them and puts them in cabinet. In the past, I remember there were three accounting officers that were investigated by the Auditor General and Parliament, and Parliament recommended that the president sacks them. One of them was Pius Vigirimana, the other one was Kagoda, but the third one was actually Lukwago. And apart from Kagoda, the two others are still accounting officers. They are still serving. So the president, now I saw the Minister for Ethics, Akero Rose. She presented a report and said, we have recovered 223 billion from government officials who are corrupt, who had taken this money. We have recovered it from them. But she was challenged and was asked, how come you've not told us these officials and the steps you're taking to prosecute them? Name and shame them. They didn't do it. So it looks like they are shielding them, because we don't know them, but they're only telling us the figures. So
they're adducing evidence. They're picking together, bringing together evidence to prosecute them. So
maybe,
I think.
Maybe. So there is a thinking that the president and the other top leaders in this country have not done enough to seriously fight.
But what have you and I done?
Corruption. I am doing my part. I am speaking and I am sharing information and I am making reference to the Transparency International report. So I am
To wind up on this conversation. Let's give John some minutes as we wind up.
Okay, I wanted to say that I think Uganda has made steps in the fight against corruption, and I think we also need to define
the different
forms of corruption and levels of corruption that exist. And then we need to be clear what we are discussing about. There are so many things that we need to do. For example, the IGG has said that in order to fight corruption, there's a certain number of laws that have to be passed, like the Whistleblowers Act, mm-hmm. which will enable people to come out as witnesses, so that when they speak against corruption, there's protection. Mm. They need laws to take property of the corrupt. You know, the laws are not there. Like the theme says, corruption is now, everybody needs to own the war against corruption. Mm-hmm. Then also, I think we always mix corruption and moral judgments, and people who make past mistakes, what should be done to them? I think in Uganda, we shouldn't say somebody made a mistake. After they have been punished, then we need to continue punishing them. So in law, we have to watch what's called double jeopardy. A person could make a mistake, but doesn't mean that they are the mistake for the rest of their life.
Yeah. All right, we're out of time. Moses, do you have something to conclude with?
No, my conclusion is to implore, especially the top leaders, when they are special appointing leaders, CEOs and commissioners and accounting officers, they should look for people who have a record of high integrity. Because if you do not have people of high integrity occupying the top positions in our state institutions, it would become extremely hard for us to get any headway, to get any progress in the battle against corruption.
All right. Thank you, gentlemen, for making time to discuss with us a lot of issues of Anti-Corruption Day, but also the behavior of parliamentarians and ministers. And now one of them is going to be censured. We don't know. That debate is going to happen sometime soon once Parliament comes together and they debate that. Hopefully, they can find... John here was advocating for a second chance for her. Hopefully that can be given, but and lots others. But it is Christmas season, and I want to urge you that we here at New Vision are doing a magical Christmas. You win yourself a free meal for two at Cakely. This is what you're going to do. Subscribe to the New Vision e-paper for 2 weeks and stand a chance to win just a free meal for two at Cakely. What you do, visit epapers.visiongroup.co.ug, and of course you never know, you could win yourself a meal, or you could even do other lots of things. We're going to take a break. When we return, Rush Talk. Today's a Friday, and the World Cup is going on. We're going into the quarterfinals. Very interesting. So we need to get into those and have conversations on how it is going. We're going to take a look at we have sports analyst and musician, but definitely look at the World Cup and how it is going so far. Do stick around. A very good morning.